the romance and
let's go straight across to another Shiv Bhakt, Bhakt of the Adi Yogi. I have a huge amount of respect for him. Namaskaram Sadhguruji. I am here in Kashi. It's a divine, surreal moment for me. But I would request you first up to please tell our viewers what Kashi means to us.
Namaskaram Ananda. I'm not able to see you, I'm hearing you though. so you're denying me the Kashi Darshan. Or your technical team denying me the Kashi Darshan, make sure I can also see, huh? You are there. Anyway,
well, my apologies. Yeah, my apologies, but this is technology. But please tell us, Sadhguruji, we'll show you, I'll send you the feed, I'll send you the pictures.
Yes. Well, my heart fills with joy that today there is some revival of Kashi, making it a little more presentable to the world, because Kashi is not just a place of worship. The word Kashi literally means a tower of light. It is an instrument, a consecrated, powerful yantra created to connect the micro and the macro, or the individual and the universal. The Kashi as a yantra had over 72,000 shrines. As human body has 72,000 nadis, accordingly, this is an immense human form created so that it can connect with the cosmic form. So, as we say, it is Vishwanath, the Lord of the world. So, this is not about a specific religion, this is for the entire world. It touches every life on this planet, not just humans. Every life on this planet, this must be understood, because this is Sanatan culture. Sanatan means eternal. That which is eternal cannot be exclusive. That which is eternal has to be inclusive. And that is what Kashi represents. And it's today fantastic that we have at least made a partial renovation of how we approach the temple, because every time I went to Kashi, I put my head down in shame as to how in narrow gullies, dirty little alleys, we were approaching the temple. This is a grand effort, and my congratulations and blessings to all who worked for this.
Why is Kashi important to us? Because you are somebody who has advocated the restoration of Kashi, and you have spoken at length about it. Will you please expand on it tonight, sir?
See, one thing is, it is the oldest city on the planet, living city on the planet. It is older than legend, in Mark Twain's words. Well, when Rome was not even thought of, Kashi was. When Athens had not entered people's heads, Kashi was. Before the phenomena of Egypt happened, Kashi was. So Kashi is significant that one thing is, it's an ancient city. Another important thing, as I already said, it is a mechanism. People went there for realization, people went there for transcendence, because this is what Kashi means, that there is a tower of light, an energetic process, where if you become available to this, it transports you to the dimensions which are beyond. When we say dimensions beyond, every spiritual seeker is wanting to experience something beyond his own physical nature. This is what the whole seeking is about. So Kashi is an instrument which uplifts everybody. Not everybody may have a lifelong spiritual sadhana. For every ordinary human being who have spent their life in various other aspects, at least towards the end of their life, they must go to Kashi, because the uplifting process, the transcendence, is available free for every human being, no matter what kind of lives they have lived throughout their life. That is the significance of Kashi.
Well, Sadhguruji, if I may ask you, do we need as a nation an awakening of our chetana? And will, have we moved away from our civilizational pivot?
See, just 2 days ago, I was talking to some of the top scientists in neurological sciences and also physicists and others. you know, sponsored by a center in Harvard Medical School. And I was telling them the entire last part of 19th century and the entire 20th century largely has gone to study the physical aspects of existence and creation. 21st century and future must dedicate itself to the subjectivity of the human being, subjectivity of life itself, because without addressing the subjectivity, we are treating every life like material. We are treating every life as a source for something else. Well, even nations, even India is being referred to as an emerging market. We are a marketplace for somebody. We are not human beings. This has to go without science addressing the subjectivity of life. Life will have no meaning. It'll become all material. So much technology has come, but unfortunately, most of the technology is being used not for the well-being of life, always against life, not by intent, but simply because of lack of inclusive approach, lack of being aware of the significance of subjectivity. Here is Kashi. Kashi, a few thousand years ago, has addressed the subjectivity, and this is what you're referring to as Chetana. Do we have to awaken that? It is not just for the nation. The Chetana of the world, the Chetana of every human being on this planet needs to be awakened. This is why right now we are striving, we are running a global movement called Conscious Planet. This is what it means, to awaken the Chetana of every human being on this planet.
Will reviving Sanatan Pratha, or going back to our roots and reviving our Vedic scriptures, because 94-95% of our scriptures are all science. It's about becoming one with the universe and respecting the energy of the cosmos, and with that, with the elements of our planet. Do you think reviving Sanatan Pratha is going to help temples?
See, temples were the instruments of this. See, if you go to the temple, it is not about worship, it is not about appealing to God to do this or that, save me, protect me, that's not what it's about. It's just about darshan, which means to behold an energetic form which will imprint itself in your heart and bring about a new possibility. This is not a place where you go and petition, this is not even a place of prayer. Now, these days, everybody's thinking temple is a place of prayer. No, this must be corrected. You go to temple only to imbibe the divine form, because this is a culture where we don't look up to the divine. We want the divine to imprint itself in us, so that the divine footprint within our minds and hearts will make us into a divine possibility. That's what this whole culture is about. This is very vital for the world, because this whole process of thinking divine is somewhere and it gets angry with you, it's pleased with the nice words that you say, it is going to bestow gifts to you. This is a very childish way of looking at life. The Sanatan sthanas that are there, which you're referring to as temples, must be revived, must be built with the necessary scientific process, must be taken back for the purpose for which it was built, rather than just converting them into religious places. This is very important for every citizen of Bharat, and very important for the entire world.
Very rightly said, there is a science and we need to appreciate the science and learn that science and respect that, not just the theology or the religious aspect of it. My final question to you, Sadhguruji, as a Param Bhakt of the Adi Yogi, what are you feeling today? It's early morning for you, you are on the other side of the world. I thought I would bump into you in Kashi.
You will in a few days maybe, if you stay.
Well, thank you very much, Sadhguruji, for speaking with us. Yeah,
me,
you're telling me.
About me being a Param Bhakt, I'm not a devotee of Adi Yogi. He is my sleeping partner, 50% partner, but he makes me do all the work, but it's all his. He owns everything, but I do all the work.
What very well. Very well said, Sadhguruji. Always a pleasure speaking with you, and I very humbly and sincerely thank you for making the time. I know you are having a very pressing schedule. but you have done this one for a Shiv Bhakt and a Baba and for Baba Bholenath. So thank you very much, Sadhguruji. So that was Sadhguru, and from one Shiv Bhakt to another, ladies and gentlemen, earlier in the evening I was in conversation with author Amish Tripathi. Listen in, he was overwhelmed, very emotional with what has happened today. Listen in to what he had to say. Amish Tripathi with us. Amish ji, namaste, har har Mahadev, I must say, because I'm coming to you live from Bhole Baba's Nagari at Kashi Vishwanath.
Namaste, har har Mahadev.
How would you see this occasion today?
No, this is a civilizational moment. I'm coming to you live from Lanka, actually. I'm here shooting a documentary on the Ramayana. And as you all know, Ravan was a very devout Shiv Bhakt as well, as was Lord Ram, actually. And for anyone who is a Shiv Bhakt, indeed, anyone who is an Indian, this is a proud moment. There is, since when Aurangzeb broke the original Kashi Vishwanath ji Mandir a few centuries ago, we didn't have a temple for a few decades. Ahilyabai Holkar, the great Maratha queen, actually rebuilt the Kashi Vishwanath ji as we see it today, which was, of course, not at the site of the original Kashi Vishwanath ji temple, but over time, houses grew around it, the lanes became smaller. I have roots in Kashi. My father's family is from Kashi. My grandfather used to teach at Banaras Hindu University. So, therefore, I've had the privilege of worshipping at Kashi Vishwanath ji from when I was a little child. And I remember that the temple did not... there was wondrous spiritual energy in Kashi Vishwanath ji, but the path to the temple was through small, tiny lanes, which were frankly quite filthy. The temple complex was tiny. So many of us didn't have the pleasure of even spending enough time with Baba at the temple, because there was such a rush of crowd. And of course, it did not feel, one felt culturally, in a way, depressed going out there, because the greatest temple of our God of Gods himself, the Mahadev, was in such a sorry state. And we all know that Gangaji is very dear to Lord Shiva, and Gangaji is a proud devotee of Lord Shiva, which is why Gangaji actually changes direction at Kashi and then turns away once again. And the belief amongst us Kashi people is she does that to show her honor and respect for the city of the Mahadev, the city of Lord Shiva, Kashi. And can you imagine that for a few centuries from Kashi Vishwanath ji, we couldn't see the Gangaji, and from Gangaji, we couldn't see Kashi Vishwanath ji. And that, phenomenon, that beauty, the feeling that any Shiv Bhakt would have on seeing Gangaji and Vishwanath ji together was lost for a few centuries. It has been revived now because of this project. It's a wondrous project. It's, in my opinion, in my humble opinion, a civilizational move.
Well, the quest to revive Kashi and to find our spiritual connect and pivot continues. Hope you enjoyed this broadcast live from Down on Ground here at Kashi on the Dashashwamedh Ghat. It's been a surreal experience for me, ladies and gentlemen. It's just amazing. Every time I come here, there is something that pulls me to Baba Bholenath. So we'll try and go and see if we can sneak a late night darshan. Signing out. Thank you for watching.